A very good afternoon to all of you. Thank you for being here with us. Welcome to this panel discussion on how to get EU enlargement back on track, prioritizing rule of law and judicial reform. Now, this discussion event is our starting point for the Jean Monnet EU network project, Western Balkans to EU, Europeanization meets democracy, on the search for a new European and democratic momentum. In this network project, there are 17 of us, 17 policy institutes, think tanks, university departments from 16 countries. Now, we will be working together over at least the next 3 years. We will be producing 45 policy briefs, organize dozens of discussion events in the different countries, organize ideas labs, publish op-eds, and one book where we will all put our findings together. And we will all do this with one main objective, which is to analyze, to discuss, to push for reform, to support civil societies, to connect with each other, and to bring the countries of the Western Balkans closer to the European Union. Now, the status quo of the EU enlargement and reform process is no cause for satisfaction, to put it mildly. That's why we need new impetus and we need more political engagement. The process needs pragmatism, optimism, and it needs change. It needs to accelerate, it needs to refocus and redefine priorities, and we need to finally put a brake on democratic backsliding. Progress is needed on both sides of the negotiating table. Without serious reforms in the countries of the Western Balkans and without a serious modernization of the structures of the European Union, we will be getting nowhere. Now, each year, our project will be dedicated to one particular challenge. The first year, it will be on rule of law and justice. Then we will focus on the social dimension of change. And finally, on democratization from below. Now, we are very honored to have a very interesting lineup of people for today's event, which I would like to introduce to you. Let me welcome Katarina Balley. Katarina Balley is the Vice President of the European Parliament, and before that, she has held several cabinet posts on the federal level in Germany, including a term as Minister of Justice. I would very much like to welcome Nikola Dimitrov. Welcome, Nikola.
Thank you.
Nikola is Deputy Prime Minister of North Macedonia in charge of EU affairs. He is a former foreign minister and a long-serving diplomat. I would very much like to welcome also Karoline Edtstadler. Welcome. Karoline is a Minister for Europe and Constitution in Austria, former member of the European Parliament, and State Secretary, former State Secretary for Home Affairs. And of course, Jovana Marović. Very welcome, Jovana. She's Executive Director of Politikon Network, a think tank based in Montenegro, Podgorica. Now, Vedran Cihic from the Austrian Institute for International Politics and myself, we will be chairing the discussion over the next 60 minutes. My name is Paul Schmidt. I'm heading the Austrian Society for European Politics in Austria, Vienna. And if you have any questions or comments which you would like us to integrate into the discussion, don't hesitate to send us your comments or questions via Facebook or Twitter or any other means. And our network is here also with us, and they can send us their remarks via the chat function of Zoom, so we can try to pose them to our panel. Now, to kickstart the whole discussion, I would like to start, if I may, with Karoline Edtstadler. Karoline, we are not really living through very glorious days of EU enlargement. Now, for many years we talked about enlargement fatigue, and today someone in our network said, well, this is not fatigue anymore, this has developed into a general apathy. Now, in times of crisis, no one really seems to pay attention very much or care very much about what's going on in our nearest neighborhood. Now, the main question is, Karoline, what do we need to do? How do we get this process back on track?
Thank you so much, first of all, for the invitation for this very interesting discussion, because we are discussing two issues which are very important parts of my portfolio. We are talking about the enlargement process and the enlargement as such, and the rule of law. And you mentioned that I'm not only Minister for EU, but also for constitutional affairs. And I was a former judge, I may mention also. And therefore, the rule of law is something which is very important. I wouldn't see it as negative as you just stated, or as I took your statement, because I think we achieved quite a lot last year, especially at the beginning of last year. We were already in the middle of this pandemic when we decided to go further with the enlargement process, when we decided the accession starting point for North Macedonia and Albania. And that was not easy. I remember quite well my first day in post as a minister for Europe. And I was traveling to Paris because I tried to persuade them to go with us. So we need unanimity in the council for the accession process. And I always said it's a question of credibility for the European Union. It's a question also of security for Europe, that we are bringing the Western Balkans closer to the European Union, of course, with the goal of a membership in the European Union. And everyone knows that for Austria, that is really high on the agenda. And I think since 2018, and I may say that since the Austrian presidency in the Council of the European Union, we did a lot, we achieved a lot, but you are quite well. When you are a bit negative, because since March and the decision to opening the process, the accession process for these two countries, it was a bit grumpy. We were really working hard to get the first governmental conference for North Macedonia and Albania together with the German presidency, but it was not possible. We do really hope that after the elections in Bulgaria have taken place, that we can get further with this process, and we are standing side by side with North Macedonia and also Albania, because I think we need these signals in times like that.
Thank you so much, Ms. Edtstadler. Let's travel via Zoom to North Macedonia, to Nikola Dimitrov. Nikola, I mean, you did a lot in the last few years. You managed a change of government. There was so much hope at the beginning. You tried and did a lot in managing expectations, both towards the European Union, but also towards the Macedonian, North Macedonian population in North Macedonia. And the question today, 2021, having in mind the state of play with your neighbor, but the state of the play in the European Union, the state of the play of the pandemic. Where do we stand? Was that enough? What needs to be the next step to not only manage the expectations better, but to achieve the change that you basically kicked off a few years ago?
Thank you, Vedran. Great to see you all, even virtually like this. Inspired by this sort of title, putting enlargement back on track, I have to say that many years ago, the process was resembled the highway. Then it became small, and now I think it's very tiny and it's uphill. And sometimes I think of it in my mind, as we have this saying in the country, an uphill path with thorns and rocks for goats when they climb. And to put the European perspective of North Macedonia into our perspective, This year, we mark 2 decades, 20 years since we signed the Association and Stabilization Agreement. And we mark 16 years as a candidate country. So all this waiting time is very and is challenging. And we waited because we had an issue with our neighbors in Athens. We resolved it. Then there was an issue with the trust in the accession process itself. So we had to wait for the new methodology. And we followed the words of the Council in June 18 that the path will be paved to start accession talks in June 19. In June 19, the Council said we will revert to the matter in October 19. Then finally, we got the green light in March last year at the start of this horrible pandemic of COVID-19. But the EU was not able to deliver on that decision, which in our case was not preconditioned with concrete reform steps. So I think from our perspective, and I think among friends, we have to be open and straightforward. There is an issue with the credibility on the part of the European Union. And I think this reflects not only in our case, but lessons are being learned in capitals in the Western Balkans beyond the country. Second, to be also self-critical, I think the region is also behind on the delivery of the reforms. Last year in October, if we compare the assessments of the Commission, we are far from where we would like to be, but on the political criteria, we are actually slightly ahead the countries that are in the accession process for a number of years. This year, we have some mixed reporting. We have a negative trend on the report of the Transparency International that measures perceptions of corruption. On the other hand, we have made the most progress in Europe, including the EU. Of course, many member states are much better, but our trend is the most positive trend in the whole of Europe when it comes to the state of our democracy. So I think we are ready to start the process. We are fully committed to finding a way out of this deadlock with our neighbors in Sofia, in particular after their elections. A lot is at stake for us, for the neighborhood, I think for the European Union itself as well. At the same time, in parallel, because I think it would have been a mistake to focus only on the obstacle, we produced and the government adopted a reform agenda called Agenda Europe at Home, that will enable us to focus in particular on the areas that are covered in the first fundamentals cluster as per the new methodology. And I think this will enable us not only to talk about perspective and to talk about the bilateral issues, but also to deliver at home, which I think is probably the most important priority. After the immunization process, I think this issue is definitely the top on the minds of the Macedonian citizens. And lastly, I want to express gratitude to Vienna. I don't know whether it is about the geographic proximity or its vision and leadership, but I think the whole region benefits from your insight and engagement and support in a number of areas, in particular on making this European future more tangible. We are talking about a region that does not really simply border the EU map, the region is encircled with the blue, flecked with yellow stars. And we are so deeply entrenched with the common market in terms of trade and investment coming from the member states. Our security interests are so interlinked with the security interests of the European Union that we have to fix this. We have to make this region properly European in terms of the values of Europe. And we have to fix both sides of the equation. The political will among the member states to move when there is progress, and the political will of the candidate countries and the countries in the process to change and to reform. And we have to be more honest about this equation. Political hijacking of the process on bilateral issues has always been an issue, has always been a problem. It undermines conditionality, which is a sine qua non for the accession process to work. We deliver, you deliver. Otherwise, the process fails. And in particular, bilateral issues that are arguably, we don't have time to cover that, against some of the fundamental principles and values of the European Union, such as linguistic and cultural diversity on our continent. It's not a territorial dispute. It's not a matter of closing down a nuclear plant. But I have to say, and I'm going to end with this, I am a Macedonian. My name is Nikola. And I should not choose between being Macedonian who speaks a Macedonian language and becoming European in terms of being part of the European Union. This is an anti-European choice. And member states, and we're going to work a lot with our neighbors in Sofia to make that point. This is a question for us and our people, and no other country should interfere in our right of self-determination. Thank you.
Thank you, Nikola. I think there are a lot of issues now on the table, and I would like to quickly move to Katarina Balle. Karoline Edtstadler, in the beginning, rightly pointed out that the process is on track, but the track is a sort of a bumpy road sometimes. And Nikola said, well, it used to be a highway. It's now an uphill battle and a small path with a lot of hurdles on the way, which he described. But he also said, we have to fix this on both sides because it's not that the Western Balkans is just a neighborhood. It's within the European Union. It belongs to the European Union. Katarina, what do you make of this? How do we fix this?
Well, first of all, thank you for the invitation and for this this great initiative. I think this is exactly what we need to bring stakeholders together and to discuss this. I admit sometimes frustrating issue, which is frustrating also for us because, I mean, we have been hearing about the European Union and, of course, we have only experts, I think, present here. So everybody knows that the European Union acting are mainly three bodies who act quite differently and whose approaches are differently also. And I used to be, as you rightly said, member of the federal German government. So I know how the council works and I know how difficult it is to work to achieve results there. But now I represent the parliament and I would like to underline that the parliament has always been extremely clear and has always taken a side for the accession countries in all of the disputes that we have seen and does so in this case also when it comes to Bulgaria. And I think we have to really put this into a bigger picture because the frustration that Nikola expressed, which I wholeheartedly understand, is part of a process that does not only concern the accession process. We are witnessing developments within the European Union that are extremely worrying and also frustrating for some of us. I mean, I used to be a judge myself, like Karolina. I work for the German Constitutional Court, so rule of law is my everything. And so you can imagine what I've been working on since I entered the European Parliament in 2019. And we are extremely worried and extremely upset on how the other two institutions are handling the rule of law towards member states. And this does, I believe, I mean, I've only been a member of the Parliament for 1.5 years now. So I can only give you my experience. I think that this does have an impact on how the accession questions are being discussed, that the rule of law has become more prominent, that it has a more important role. If you ask people, citizens as well as politicians, a lot of people are convinced that the accession, especially of Bulgaria and Romania, were not well enough prepared. So it's about, you know, not making the same mistakes several times. I absolutely underline what Nikola said. Once you make promises, you have to keep them. And once you raise expectations, you have to meet them. And what we have seen, especially with Albania and Northern Macedonia, the European Union has not raised to these expectations and has not kept the promises that it made. And we have to be as clear as that, the Parliament is. And I think this revised enlargement methodology is actually a good approach, putting the rule of law very much in the forefront of the discussion. But yes, we also have more involvement of the member states, and we really have to solve these issues. And I'm completely on. It's not a secret. I'm completely on the Northern Macedonian side here, as well as we try to be helpful to solve the problems with Greece. But we are very clear, and we take this position. But in the end, the problem is usually either within the member states or sometimes on the Commission side, but more often on the Council side. So we as a Parliament do whatever we can to support the accession countries there.
Thank you so much, Katarina. Balli. I mean, now we are all Macedonians, Nikola. Feel it. I mean, you have all the support that you need. But I mean, there are still a few other countries in the region, and I would argue some of them are much bigger problem than North Macedonia. I mean, we haven't mentioned Serbia so far. We haven't mentioned my home country, Bosnia and Herzegovina, so far. So there is a huge set of open questions, but it might be that we can pick it up in the second round. Let's now go to the Adriatic coast, to the seaside. Jovana Marović is in the wonderful city of Kotor. And if you haven't beaten Kotor, use this opportunity. Jovana, yesterday within the network and today in an internal meeting, we discussed a lot about different aspects of rule of law. We spoke about the rule of law culture. We spoke about the need to establish a rule of law constituency. And we spoke about the role that also civil society can and should play. You have been working in the civil society, in the think tanks for quite a long time. You have been following the development of the rule of law. And my first question would be basically from your point of view, from this other perspective, what's basically at stake right now? Where do we stand? And secondly, using the fact that we have 100 days of the new Montenegrin government in office, it will be amazing to hear one or two thoughts on the performance so far and on whether the rule of law and justice, transparency, freedom of media, et cetera, played or do play a role for the new Montenegrinian government. So, Jovana, Zoom is yours. Let us take us to the seaside.
Thanks, Radvan. Here comes another frustrating voice from the region. So it's obvious that our perspective of the enlargement process is quite different from the one from the EU level. And I think that the two most important questions about the EU enlargement are whether the EU is still interested to help the democratization of the Western Balkans and in that sense to reduce security threats from its own borders and also to prevent some geopolitical implications in this part of Europe. And the second thing is there anything left from the EU transformative power if the EU is not able anymore to export democracy, not even in its own member states and not in the Western Balkans? So I guess that these are the answers to the questions why the EU should care more about the rule of law in the Western Balkans. And in that sense, the first thing which comes to my mind is that the changes which happened in Montenegro, but also in Kosovo, and also at some point, at some extent, at local level in Bosnia and Herzegovina, are really important some developments in the Western Balkans, which should be taken into consideration. But I guess that we are, this is not enough, even if the countries are changing their political elites, which also happened in North Macedonia a few years ago. So in that sense, there are some developments in the Western Balkans, but without a clear vision where this whole process is leading and without engagement from the EU level, I don't see that we will achieve certain level of democratization in the meantime. To answer to your question, what should the civil society, the countries of the region, but in the first place, the EU do in order to foster democratization? I think that the EU should focus more on, let's say, small victories in order to gain the long-term goals. In that sense, I guess that there were some good practices as the roaming prices in the region. And then I guess that the second thing should be vaccines that should be provided to the Western Balkans. And something which will be beneficial for the citizens, because at this point they are caught between the local elites, which are corrupt and which are not delivering, not all of them, but some of them. And also between the EU, which is trying to keep the status quo in the Western Balkans. But I guess that the status quo is not longer providing stability in this part of Europe, basically because of the growing nationalism in some of the countries and because of the growing interest from the non-EU actors in first place, Russia and China. When it comes to the changes in Montenegro, yes, we managed to change the government after 30 years. And that's probably the sign that the country and the society in Montenegro are more with more democracy than in the rest of the Western Balkans, keeping in mind that the transition of the power and everything. But, you know, the changing of the political elite is just first step towards the democratization. There are lots of issues currently which are problematic in Montenegro: depolarization, growing nationalism, problems in the work of the new government, meaning the lack of the peer strategy, the lack of coordination, and lots of other issues. But when it comes to the EU enlargement process, this country, the government is trying to focus on the fight against corruption and organized crime, putting it at high at the agenda. In that sense, the parliament is now trying to change the laws on prosecution, but with a negative opinion from the European Union. Now we have a deeply politicized prosecution, which is under the influence of the previous majority and the DPS of Milo Djukanovic. So basically, we have two options: to go with this law, which is not good in my opinion, or I agree with the opinion of the European Commission. But the second thing is that the European Union is criticizing, European Commission and the Venice Commission are criticizing this solution,
but not providing the concrete recommendations and guidelines how to overcome this situation. And in that sense, with deeply politicized institutions, we cannot achieve more in the democratization process. So I guess that that's the first thing for the European Union, that they should provide clear guidelines for the countries. And if this country is delivering, there should be clear rewards for it.
Thank you, Jovana. Jovana, you've also emphasized the concept and the principle of the rule of law and the tensions which you see. I would like to move also to Karoline Edtstadler, because I know that the discussion on the rule of law is something that you are very interested in and that you put a lot of focus on. And we're receiving a lot of messages via Facebook, YouTube, and Twitter on this issue of the rule of law. So keep sending us messages. And I would like to put them to you, Karoline. One message is, from your point of view, what should the EU do differently to successfully tackle the rule of law crisis in the Western Balkans? And let me add to this maybe something that we have heard yesterday in our network discussions. We had with us yesterday the co-chair of the Helsinki Committee in Hungary, and she was very concerned about the role of Hungary and the copy-pasting, as she put it, the copy-pasting of bad practices on the rule of law, and she mentioned some examples there. The impact that Hungary and the way the EU deals with Hungary has on the region of the Western Balkans. And she was asking the question, or we were discussing the question, what can be done, in fact, to help changing the political culture? What can be done from the outside to help changing the political culture? So there are basically two questions. What can be done to help this transformation process, and what could be an European approach to improve the rule of law?
Well, first of all, I'm not sure if Nikola and others from this region are happy if they hear about the rule of law crisis. And you, in the second question, mentioned then that we also do have a lot of discussions on rule of law within the European Union. And I was always very strict in discussions also within the European Union when we were talking about the accession process regarding the Western Balkans, that I said, okay, we have to do our homework also in the European Union. And I think we achieved a lot in the last months regarding the safeguarding, to put it like that, of our core values. One of our core values is the rule of law. And if we are not safeguarding this core value, then I don't know where we are standing in a few years. So the first answer is that we have to include more intensively the countries of the Western Balkans. And all the people who were talking now before me mentioned the same. I think we need a more political, a strategic approach on the EU enlargement process. And I fully second what Katarina Balli said. We shouldn't do the same mistakes as we already did in the past, because we should not lose out of sight that if we are not giving a clear perspective for the countries on the Western Balkan towards the European Union, then the influence from other countries like Russia, like China, is increasing. And we saw that already during the crisis very clearly. I remember when I was going together with the foreign minister of Austria, Alexander Schallenberg, during the crisis to Serbia, to Kosovo and Albania, we distributed somehow things they needed at that time. But in some countries, you saw clear the Chinese wordings everywhere. And you could see that China helped them more efficiently, I would say, than the European Union, or more visibly, maybe also. So I think that is also the answer towards the rule of law. If we give them the clear perspective, if we, and we are, I'm very self-critical with the European Union at that point, if we are not starting to do that more effectively in the next few weeks, I think then we are constantly losing influence also, and we are hopes are destroyed. And I remember also already 2016, I had discussions with a colleague of mine at the European Court of Human Rights from North Macedonia, and he said, Caroline, if you're not giving us a perspective, we are turning away. And as Nikola mentioned, it's not only enclosed and included by European area, the Western Balkan area, but it's really like a gap missing in the European Union when you're looking at the map. So the clear perspective can help, and I'm sure and I know that especially Albania and North Macedonia are doing a lot already at that stage before the opening of the accession process, the official start to go in the right direction regarding justice, freedom and security and also rule of law. So it's really also up to us. The second question regarding Hungary, I would say here we achieved a lot in the last months. It was also a bumpy way, but we did it, that we do have the conditionality now between the MFF and the rule of law. And I think that's really one of the most important things, even if there is now the possibility, and they did it already, to go to the European Court of Justice. That's okay, that's included, so to say, but I'm sure that it will hold, that the European Court of Justice will do its utmost to decide quickly. And then we really do have another mechanism to stop things in a way that it hurts. I have to put it like that. I'm not a diplomat. We mentioned that already. I was a criminal judge. To bring people, to bring politicians, to bring governments back on track of the rule of law. So here, I think we also have with the new rule of law mechanism in the council, in the meantime, more mechanisms to tackle this problem. And it's, of course, also something we have to tackle within the European Union.
Thank you, Karoline Edtstadler. Nikola, you mentioned the Europe at Home initiative, and it was born to a certain extent out of this kind of a very deep conviction that all of the countries of the Western Balkans have to do everything they can to improve living standards, rule of law, institutions. But to a certain extent, from outside, we got the feeling that it was born out of the need to do something in times where the winds from Brussels and from Sofia are quite strong. I would love to ask you, I mean, in this process, Europe at Home, you consulted civil society, you tried to push and to implement the new EU methodology. And we know that in North Macedonia, there is a huge support of the population for the process, like more than 70% of the population is for the EU enlargement. At the same time, they have quite, unrealistic expectations what the EU can deliver. I believe that without deblocking and the process with Sofia and starting real negotiations, Europe at Home will be limited and will remain a limited tool. Tell me what you think about this one, and if you could just share a few insights on the role of civil society, because in your country it was so fundamentally important to topple the regime of Gruevski. Speaking about the broader region, we see many civic initiatives popping up. We see people starting to be engaged, pro-European, emancipatory, around free and fresh air, air pollution, et cetera, corruption. It would be great to get a kind of a feeling from your side on the civil society and civic initiatives point.
Thank you. So, two questions, I think, essentially. The first one, I think, including on the issue with Sofia, but also how we are looked at by the member states, by the those that are not directly involved in the problem, and plus this support of the people the idea to put the recommendations of all the subcommittees of the association and stabilization process, the suggestions of the European Commission enshrined in the report of October last year, other Venice Commission, GRECO, etc., put it all together, built a mechanism to follow up and report on implementation with clear tasks and who is in charge to implement in the system. I think this is important on so many levels. It helps us to be seen as a country that, in spite of the difficulties, knows where it wants to go. And delivery is critically important for the people, because even if we don't have access to the accession process as a reform tool, the goal of the accession process is not to tick boxes and one day say, we join the EU. The goal is to bring Europe at home, hence the title. That is, bring European standards and the acquis so that we here can have a European way of life without really going to Austria, Germany, Italy, etc. So the region is in this race with time between bringing Europe at home so that people and families can stay and have a European way of life in the region, or they move as economic migrants individually with their families to member states. And I say race with time because if my generation is not able to make this breakthrough, it's going to be really unfair to the next one and probably more difficult. The brain drain is a huge issue. The economic gap is a huge issue. So we don't have too much time. And I've been talking about this for the last 4 years as an accidental politician. We have to replace the discussion on how important we are historically and how old we are as nations and ethnic and ethnicity with the discussion on accountability, good jobs, clean air, clean waters, rivers and lakes, etc., with things that matter. And this is what the accession process is about. We have, based on the explanatory screening, a very solid level of alignment, more than we expected. I think it's going to be slightly less than 50%. And we have to now focus on implementation. And on rule of law, this Europe at home, we have a good legal framework. It's now about implementation. The key and the tricky part is the reforms in the judiciary must be implemented by the judiciary itself. They cannot be imposed by the government or we end up in another state capture situation. So we need the Judicial Council and the Council of the Public Prosecutors to use the mechanism in the current legislation. They started with that. They have dismissed 10 judges so far. We are trying to equip courts and public prosecutors' offices throughout the country. We try to digitalize them. We are implementing HR strategies in terms of more resources, human resources. We have the OSCE that monitors cases of high importance, high-level corruption, etc., and we ask them to do it and welcome them to do it. So, but we don't really still have, if there is such, a magical stick on rule of law. Sometimes I think because institutions are people, and I think we need champions of integrity. We need islands and courts that will create a perception in the public that things are moving, that they don't pick up phones when, if and when politicians call. So it's not an easy thing to do, to reform the judiciary. And last point on civil society, we have learned as a society that politicians move and changes are possible when people are loud. And today as well, I think there is a culture of responsiveness being developed, because when the public opinion becomes angry, institutions move. Government changes its positions, etc. So without the civil society, this profound transformation that we have to do will not be possible. Political will is necessary. The tools are important. The incentive is important. But the demand is also important. And the demand comes from the bottom, from the society. And I want to end on a somewhat optimistic note, because I think we won't have time for another round, with my new favorite quote. And it comes from the movie Good Night and Good Luck. It's about a veteran journalist who took on Senator McCarthy in his fight in the United States. Edward Morrow, who says, "Difficulty is the excuse history never accepts." So this all is very difficult, but it is also extremely important. And we have, and we will find a way to fix it, the enlargement process.
Now, it's difficult. It's difficult. It's important, but it is also a huge opportunity, which we should seize. And I wanted to see whether Katarina Balkans has found that magical stick that we would need to to support the rule of law and the champions of integrity, as Nikola put it. Nikola, yes. Also, Katarina, Nikola also mentioned the importance of a transformation from below, the pressure of public opinion. Should the EU in its efforts and its support maybe focus much more on supporting and mobilizing and helping civil society building up that pressure rather than have a government-to-government institutionalized institution-government negotiation? How do you see it?
Well, there are so many things that I would like to say now that have been raised. I have to focus on a few. Starting with your last point, yes, of course. I mean, the bottom-up approach is extremely important. Only, and we have to, and we will do a lot from the European Union to support civil society, especially in the parts that fight for democratic values. Only, my experience is that rule of law, independence of the judiciary, is something that is quite abstract to most people. I mean, we've seen what has been going on in Hungary for 10 years. We've been witnessing what has been happening in Poland for 5 years. And I mean, there are always occasions where people rise, but it's Viktor Orban has destroyed democracy in Hungary completely. There is no free media left. None. They just shut the last free media radio station. The independence of the judiciary is, well, there are a few independent judges still, but structurally is destroyed. We've seen that Poland has done not exactly the same, but in the effect, more or less the same. They started with the judiciary and media. Well, I won't go into details now, but what we see is that, no, the people are not rising. We have seen people rising in Poland when it came to the abortion law. And that was a situation when, I mean, I'm a public enemy in Poland because I keep speaking up against what is happening, and in Hungary also, being portrayed next to Hitler and in Hungary, Soros. And so I have nothing to lose. So I spoke up and said, look, here you see why the rule of law is nothing abstract. Because you have a constitutional court in Poland, which is set up in a way that is not constitutional, that is not conform to European law either. And now it comes to a law that really interests a lot of people in Poland, and you see that this constitutional court does exactly what the government wants. And this is my magical stick. We, as a European Union, we should not tell countries, neither member states nor accession countries, what exactly they have to do. Because that's not the way it works. We see that in Poland and in Hungary, especially the Polish are really champions in this. They keep saying, look, we just do what all of you do. I mean, in Germany, the constitutional court judges are being elected by the parliament. It's political, completely. And in Spain, you do it like this, and we just copied it. And we in Poland, we give the judges the say, so it's everything fine. No. The question, and this is the magical stick, the question is, do you accept that separation of powers and rule of law and democracy means that you as a government are being controlled and that you're being criticized and that people are going to tell you, as well journalists, as judges, that you have made mistakes and that you have to correct these mistakes and that you follow this? This is the question. It's not how you elect your judges. It's not if you organize your courts in this way or another. That's not the point. The point is, do you ensure a valid control of yourself, which is effective? And I will give you an example, not because I or my compatriots are angels, but because I so strongly believe in this. Just to give you an example, when I entered the German Bundestag, the German parliament, my party, together with the conservatives, had such a large majority in the Bundestag that the constitutional opposition rights, the quota for this, was not being met by the opposition. So they could not exercise the usual opposition rights, okay? So what did we do? We, as a government, with an enormous majority, we strengthened the opposition rights. We actually lowered the quotas for them so that they could control us. And I keep asking people in Poland and my ECR colleagues and the Hungarians, who are not EPP anymore, but whoever, is this what you would do? Do you believe in democracy and the separation of powers so much that you would do this? And of course, what they are doing is the complete opposite. They tried people like Orban, people like Kaczynski, people like Jancha, they try to silence everyone who criticizes them. They try to ensure their power for as long as possible. And this is the magical one. Do it in a way that you have effective, and not because you have to, but because you believe this is what democracy is about. That will be my answer.
Thank you so much, Katarina, Barley, and thank you so much for the passion. I believe it's crucial that we are passionate about what we believe, that we stand up for these values. I was just quickly skipping through the live chat on YouTube, on Facebook. There are a few questions. I mean, we cannot answer all of them. I mean, there are few quite critical questions. There are questions on the role of the civil society and how the EU could support movements like Pravda za Davida, for example, in Bosnia. Jovana, and there is one question in the chat. It says, elites or the majority of political elites in the Western Balkans are not interested at all in rule of law and justice, as this will fundamentally undermine their power. And I would love to have you to comment on this one, as in your op-ed for Wiener Zeitung, published just a few days ago in German, you also mentioned this trend of competitive autocratization. And the second part of the question will be, I mean, we haven't talked so much about Russia and China. I mean, we are now in the middle of the vaccine politics, vaccine wars even, new geopolitical shifting grounds. So if you could tell us one or two sentences from your perspective on that one, Jovan. I mean, I know a lot of questions, but if you could just...
And Jovana, there are two more challenges. One is what Nikola said, we're running out of time. And the second one is, you have to end, please, on an optimistic note.
Okay, I'll try. So I also published the blog like a few years ago, are the autocrats in the Western Balkans interested in the rule of law? But as I said, there are changes in the Western Balkans. So at least three of six countries are now interested in the rule of law, at least rhetorically. So I guess that the somehow the approach from the European Union level should be specific for each country. And then I guess that the message to Albania and North Macedonia about the blocking of the accession negotiations was also a message to the rest of the Western Balkans. So the core of the EU tools, we have a project which is called the old tools for the new rules. The core of the position of the European Union should be to use current mechanisms, but to use it in a different way. Just to mention and to remind you that Montenegro is negotiating for 9 years now with the European Union about the accession, and that they are backsliding, democratic backsliding in Montenegro for 9 years in a row. So I guess that we are not moving at all, and that the European Union should also insist on incentives, not just on sanctions. And because just, you know, this game of stick and carrot is now just about 60 for the Western Balkans. And I guess without some benefits, at least for the citizens of the Western Balkans, it is not encouraging even for the autocrats. So I guess that it's really important to build the rule of law culture, which should be on the part of the civil society, but also governments and the EU, and that the EU should invest more in the efforts to democratize the Western Balkans, because such process should go hand in hand with the building democracy also in the European Union. And when it comes to non-Western actors' influence in the Western Balkans, it's true that there is currently lots of influences from many states. As I said, the focus is mostly on China and Russia. But as a rule, all investments in the Western Balkans coming from the non-Western countries are problematic in terms of transparency, in terms of somehow influencing in a bad way the rule of law in the countries. So I guess that each influence which is not providing framework for democratization is not going in parallel with the European integration process, with the efforts of the countries in order to build democracy in the Western Balkans. So as I said at the very beginning, it's really important to have more active role of the European Union in order not to have this really problematic influence from the non-Western actors. And to finish on a positive note, I guess that all of us now in the Western Balkans, as I said, are aware that we have a role in democratization, and that this wave of citizens which are taking their responsibility and which are participating in collective actions is something which is really important for democracy in the Western Balkans, but this should be used for good.
Jovana, thank you so much. Thank you so much, Katarina, Balli, Karoline Edtstadler, Nikola. Thank you, Paul. I mean, we all agree that we have to bring back the story on the highway, to build the highway, to do as much as we can to progress. The project that we have will keep us busy with all these issues for the next 3 years. We will produce many policy briefs. We will produce a kind of a public buzz, and we will keep working. We never give up, Paul. So on that note, best greetings to North Macedonia. A quick total recovery, Nikola. Some Zachertorte and cakes from Vienna to Karoline Edtstadler, because we're in the same city. Jovana, best greetings to the Adriatic coasts with Barley. All the best. We all keep being passionate about Europe, because at the end, Balkans is Europe. I mean, we have to keep that in mind. This is an integral part of Europe, be it within the EU, be it outside, but we hope to be in the EU one time. So all the best. Stay in touch and enjoy the afternoon.
Good day.